Welcome to church today. Let me just begin by saying Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers in here, and we're so thankful to have you. And let me also welcome our guest. If you're a guest with us today, we're excited to have you. We have a few guests here. Some of you are here visiting with family, and some of you are just here for the first time to just get to know us as a church. And so I introduce myself to you. I'm Brady Wood. I'm the pastor here at Pleasant Grove. We're in here today because we have a building project happening in our worship center where we're expanding it and doing things to it so that we could accommodate you there for worship. I also just want to give you a brief announcement. We have a great table set up back here full of flowers, and so it's a build-your-own flower bouquet table. So if you are a mother and want to build yourself a bouquet at the end of the service, just go back there, get what you want. We just wanted to bless you. If you're a mom to be, do the same thing. Listen, after all the mothers have gotten their things, then any of the women, any of the little girls that want to go build themselves a flower bouquet, you go for it. And then if any, after that, now if there's still some left after all of that, there may not be, then if any of the little boys that want to give their mom something, then you can get something for your mama, all right? But I want to thank you for being here. Thank you, Colleen, for putting that together for us. And as we begin to go to the Lord in worship, let's all stand together and go to the Lord in prayer. Father, Lord, I thank you, God, for your goodness to us, for your love and your grace and your mercy, God, that you have given us this beautiful day here to worship you. God, as we come here today to worship, we think about our mothers and the blessing that they have been to us. Everyone in this room, God, has a mother, some still with us and some no longer with us. And Lord, we know that you giving us a mother is just such a wonderful blessing. But God, we come here today not to worship our mothers, but we come here today to worship our Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you for sending us, Jesus, your only begotten Son, to die on the cross for our sin, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus, thank you for all you've done, all you are doing. And Holy Spirit, we invite you and ask you to move among us in a very powerful, powerful way today. We pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you sing with us this morning as we celebrate victory in Jesus?
Stop.
for just a moment, and I wanted to share with you an update. We have been praying for our friends in the Ukraine, and we've been doing what we can to help provide for them there, and we have collected stuff and sent stuff off, and some of you have given financially, and as I had shared with you, we've also been praying for my brother-in-law, Shay. He led a team of three other men to Krakow, Poland, which is a neighbor there to Ukraine. Krakow, Poland has received more refugees, I believe, than any other country. And Shay was a IMB missionary there for 3 years. He and my sister and their family, and now they're here in the States, but he was given the opportunity to lead a team out there. They're there now in Poland, in Krakow, and they've been doing a great work. And so I've been in touch with him, and I asked him, I said, man, could you just make a little video and send that to me? And I'd like to show that to the church. And so we're going to try to show you this video. I remind you that we're not in our typical space with all the gadgets we normally have. So bear with us for just 1 second. And I just want to share this video with you. Just give me a second, though. Let's see. All right, testing. 1, 2, 3. See if we can get
it. Guys, I'm coming to you this evening from just right outside Krakow, Poland. We are at the home of one of our IMB missionaries. They invited us over for dinner tonight. We have had a slam-packed week of ministry while we have been here. We have seen Ukrainian kids, Ukrainian families, Ukrainian teenagers. We have been in several different refugee centers as we have been ministering throughout the week. We've been able to provide cheeseburgers for refugees in tents. We've been able to provide fruit and cereal and bread, places that need our help. Due to your prayers and your giving, we've been able to be able to provide some of those necessities that these families are needing. There are going to be multiple ways that we are going to be able to be involved in the future. There's great need here, whether it's involving Ukrainian refugees or sport camps or orphanage work. There is great need to see people come to know the Lord as their personal Savior. So pray about how you can be involved in the future. And again, thank you so much. As we have been here, we have felt your prayers and appreciate that so much. God bless.
So you can see God is doing a great work. I'm thankful for this team that was able to go, and I've been able to be on calls with them as they were preparing for this. And I just want to encourage you and remind you as a church that this is what God has called us to as His people, is to go into all the world and to make disciples of all nations. Where there seems to be trouble and difficulty, God's not called us to run from those areas, but actually to run into those areas with the good news of Jesus Christ and providing all that we can. And so I wanted to encourage you in that. I want to encourage you to keep praying for what God is doing in this world, doing through our missionaries. I want you to keep praying about what God is going to do through us as a church. And listen, down the road, God may open the door for some of us to go to some of these places on a mission trip. You may need to go ahead and start getting your passport ready. If you don't have one, you might need to get one, because we might need to take a trip somewhere like Poland in the future to be able to get our boots on the ground as well. And so I want to thank you for your faithfulness in giving here at this church. Thank you for your prayers. And I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. We are going to take up our offering this morning. As our ushers come forward, I just want to remind you that here, we give as an act of worship. We give out of what God has given to us. We recognize here at our church that everything we have is not ours. It's the Lord's. And he's given it to us, and he's called us to be good stewards of those things. And the best way that I know we can steward the things God has given us is to give it back to him. And so that's what we do here. And I just want to ask Brother Larry Chandler if you would pray for our offering this morning.
Father, we do give you praise and thanks for how you have blessed us. We thank you that we have this opportunity to worship you by returning part of it to you. We ask that you will bless that, multiply it, use it to bring glory and honor to Jesus, in whose name we ask it. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Hasn't it been wonderful to just worship together and sing these wonderful praises to God today?
Amen.
We are, listen, we are worshiping the risen Savior today. You understand that? He did come out of the tomb. And He's alive. And He's moving in power. All right, so let's worship Him today. Hasn't it been wonderful worshiping the risen Savior today?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Turn in with me in your Bible to the Gospel of John. John chapter 21. If you're with us today for just maybe the first time, we've studied through the entire book of John together over the last several months. And John chapter 21 is the final chapter in this Gospel. And over the next couple weeks, we're going to wrap all of this up. I want to go ahead and just give you a plug for next week. You need to be here next week as we look at how Jesus restores Peter into ministry. How Jesus restores Peter from being a denier of Christ to being one that Jesus tells to go and make much of Christ. If you have a friend or family member who is far from God, someone who has drifted away from the things of God, I encourage you to get them here next Sunday, because next Sunday will be definitely a Sunday of restoration, of reconciliation, a Sunday where we see that God forgives and that He restores. Today what we see is the power of the resurrected Jesus Christ. You know, all through the Gospel of John, we've seen the power of Jesus as He has performed these signs. Signs are miracles with a message. He performed all these sign miracles, and He demonstrated His power as deity, as the Son of God. The question is, what is Jesus like now that He has been resurrected? Does He still have that authority? Does He still have that power? And the answer to that is yes. And in this passage, we're going to see Jesus demonstrate how the resurrected Christ has power, He has authority, and He has compassion. So if you have found your place there, I don't have it on the screen for us today. I hope you have your Bible with you. I normally do, but today I don't. But if you have your Bible, or even if you don't, maybe you have it pulled up on a phone or a tablet or something, I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of the reading of God's Word this morning. John chapter 21, starting in verse 1, says this: "After this, Jesus revealed Himself again to His disciples by the Sea of Tiberias." Now, the Sea of Tiberias was what the Romans called the Sea of Galilee. So it's the Sea of Galilee. "He revealed Himself in this way: Simon Peter, Thomas called Twin, Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, Zebedee's sons," that's James and John, "and two others of His disciples were together." We don't know who the two others were. He said that Peter said, "I'm going fishing." "We're coming with you," they told him. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. When daybreak came, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. "Friends." Now, I'm going to come back and talk about this here in a moment. So my translation has "friends" here. The very best translation there is actually "children." It's not "friends." It's the Greek word paideon. "Friends," actually "children," says. Jesus called to them, "You don't have any fish, do you?" "No," they answered. "Cast the net on the right side of the boat," He told them, "and you will find some." So they did, and they were unable to haul it in because of the large number of fish. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I ask that You would honor the reading of Your Word. And as we study what Jesus did in this appearance to His disciples, that it would encourage us and remind us that Jesus, You have all power and authority as the resurrected Christ. You have compassion. And Lord, You can do anything. And You love us. We pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. John says this is the third resurrection appearance. John, in his gospel, he shows us, he gives us three resurrection appearances. So from the time of Jesus' resurrection, and let me remind you what has happened, and we've sung about it today. 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on the cross for your sin and for the sin of the world. His physical body was placed in a physical tomb, in a grave. And after being dead for 3 days on that Sunday morning, Jesus rose victoriously out of the grave. Physically resurrected, physical resurrected body came out of the grave, and he is alive. And the Bible tells us for 40 days he would come and go. And the disciples didn't know when he was coming and going, but he would come and appear to his disciples for 40 days. And at the end of those 40 days, Jesus took him up to a mountain and he ascended, physically resurrected Jesus, ascended to heaven. So John records three of these appearances. There's at least 10 that we know of that's recorded in the Gospels. And then there's even additional appearances of Jesus after his ascension. He appears to others. And so here he is, and he appears to his disciples for a third time here in the Gospel of John. And what it says is that before Jesus appeared to them here, that seven of these disciples, Peter being one of them, decided they were going to go fishing while they had taken these instructions from Jesus to go to Galilee. They had been waiting, and they hadn't heard from Jesus in maybe a week or so. Scholars debate on what was going on when they were fishing. Some scholars say they were being disobedient to the Lord when they went fishing because he called them to be fishers of men. And he told them to leave that profession behind. Some would argue and say that all they were simply doing was going out into the boat to maybe get some fish so that they could have something to eat because they were hungry. We don't really know exactly what's going on here. All we know is that they have gone out into the boat to go fishing, and Peter and all these other six disciples go with him, and yet as they're out in the boat, they're out in the middle of night fishing. Fishing was to be good at night on the Sea of Galilee. Now, may I remind you that most of these men were professional fishermen before Jesus called them to follow him. So these guys, it's not like you and me going out on the boat and trying to fish. These guys had spent their whole life, they had been trained up in fishing. They knew the Sea of Galilee, and they went out to go fishing that night. But the Bible tells us they fished all night and caught nothing. Now, we actually can get a little feeling of what they're going through, because anybody in here that's fished, you probably know what that feels like. To fish all day and to fish all night and not get a single bite. Here they are. Now these guys are professionals. And they fish all night, and they're using a net. And they have come up empty-handed. And as they're doing this, they may hear something that sounds familiar. Now, if you're a fisherman, and if you're not, I'll tell you what happens, okay? If you're a fisherman, you have had this experience. Different people, sometimes old-timers, sometimes not old-timers, when you're fishing, they're strangers, they don't know you from Adam. They like to give you advice. They like to give you advice. You know, you put your boat in there at the boat ramp. You're backing out to head out onto the lake. And somebody from the dock starts yelling out at you and tries to tell you what you need to be doing today when you go out there fishing. And that's common. You've probably been fishing off the bank sometime, and somebody's come by and said, "Have you caught anything?" "No, I hadn't caught anything." "Well, have you tried this?" I'm just thinking this isn't the first time that Peter and these disciples have had somebody yell out at them and say, "Hey, fellas, you caught anything today?" And with their heads kind of hanging, "No, we haven't." "Well, try this." Well, they hear a voice. They're about 100 yards from the shore. And they hear a voice come out over the waters early that morning. There may still be fog and dew up over that great Sea of Galilee. They can't see too well. They can't distinguish exactly who it is. But they hear a voice say, "Gentlemen, how's it going today out on the lake?" And they hang their heads down and they say, "Oh, here we go again." Another one of those professionals out there on the bank's going to tell us what we need to be doing. No, we haven't. About that time, that man on the shore says, "Well, take your net and cast it out on the right side of the boat." Now, I'll tell you something else about fishermen. When you haven't caught anything, you'll try just about anything. You actually listen to those guys that start telling you stuff. You're like, "Well, nothing else has worked. I've done everything else." So what do? They pull their nets up and they say, "Well, let's try it." And they cast that net out over the right side of the boat. And when they do, they can't believe their eyes. They can't believe the weight and tension. Now that net is full of fish. Jesus performs a miracle. In fact, in the Gospel of John, I have told you that there's 7 sign miracles. I had a professor that he says there's 8 sign miracles in the Gospel of John, and he includes this in as those one of the 8. In fact, in this miracle, we have 5 miracles within it. And I want to show you these miracles. But before we look at that, I want you to notice in verse 5 what Jesus says to these disciples when he called out to them. As I've already told you, your translation may say friends, it may say children, but the Greek word here is paidon, which is children, and what it means in children is it means a child still in need of instruction. A child still in need of instruction. When Jesus calls out to them, he addresses them as children who are still in need of instruction. And they were in need of instruction, but their instruction really had less to do with instructing them how to catch these fish out in the sea. Jesus wants to teach them something more important to their spiritual lives. And in fact, I've narrowed it down to about 2 things that I believe Jesus is really trying to get through to these disciples' minds, and I believe what he wants us to come away here today understanding. The first is this: he is teaching them that resurrected Christ, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, even though he went to the grave, when he was resurrected, he rose in the great power that he has always had. See, John told us in chapter 1 that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and all things were created through him. This is the same one who has created all that exists. This powerful Jesus Christ is the same Jesus who has been resurrected out of the grave and is alive forevermore. He wants his disciples to know that the miracles they saw him perform on probably a daily basis throughout those 3 years of his ministry, those miracles have not ended. Those miracles continue because he is still the all-powerful Jesus. Oh, they must remember when he turned those few fish and loaves of bread to feed the 5,000. They must remember other times when Jesus provided miraculous catches. And here Jesus is going to remind them of his great power. And even though, and Jesus knows, he is about to ascend to heaven to where he will no longer be out there with them physically like he is on this day, even from heaven, Jesus still reigns in great, great power. The power of the Son of God. He wants us to know, friends, that he can do anything. He has the power to perform any miracle that he desires to perform. That's the Jesus that we serve today. And so he's teaching them a lesson that he is still all powerful. He told them to cast the net on the right side of the boat. Friend, when you read the Bible, let me encourage you. Don't read the Bible as some would read the Bible. that would read the Bible and just always try to reason everything out. I told you a few weeks ago, and I'll stand by what I said, you can't reason the supernatural. Amen. You can't reason it. I mean, for all time, people have tried to reason out all the different things you read about in the Bible. Now, there's some things in the Bible that you can understand that way. And then there are many things in the Bible that they are just flat out supernatural. See, that's who God is. He is the supernatural God. Okay? And so, however, those fishermen got those fish in the net, we don't know exactly how, but I'll tell you one thing I do know. It was supernatural. Jesus may have called those fish and had them swim in a great pool of a great school of fish there by the boat and made them stay there until he could tell them to cast the net over there. Whatever happened that day, it was supernatural. That's the first miracle in this miracle we're seeing. It's the miracle of Jesus commanding the fish. And then obediently listening to him and casting the net out and getting a great catch. There's something else that's interesting. As I did mention to you, these men, God did definitely call them out of the profession of fishing into the profession, if you will, of being disciples of Christ, being fishers of men. Okay? Jesus had a lot more in store for them than going and spending all their time out on the lake and fishing. And in fact, them knowing Jesus is resurrected, at this moment, they should have been out proclaiming this good news to everybody that would listen. And even those that refused to listen. And isn't it interesting that we see that while they are out on the boat, They are close to the catch of fish, but they never caught them until Jesus said, cast the net over there. Listen, being obedient where God has you is so, so important. It's so important. It's not enough to just be in the right place, but it's doing the right thing at the right place when God says to do it. Amen. Listen to me. They were right there. But Jesus had already told them, you can't do anything without me. Friend, we must be sensitive in listening to the voice of God. And being obedient to him when we speak and when we discern his voice and his word and his command, when we are obedient, we will see that supernatural hand of God and we will experience these great blessings of God. Now, pick back up with me in verse 7. Look at it with me. This is really fun. If you've been with us, this will be really fun to you. But it says, the disciple, the one Jesus loved, that's John, the writer of this gospel, says the disciple, the one Jesus loved, said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tied his outer clothing around him, for he had taken it off, and plunged into the sea. If you'll remember, I don't want to call it a rivalry, but Peter and John, they kind of had a thing going amongst themselves. If you'll remember, it was Peter and John who, when Mary Magdalene came and found them as she had seen from the angels that Jesus was resurrected and that the tomb was empty, she came and she said to the disciples, she said, the body is no longer in the grave. And Peter and John took off on a foot race from miles away to get to the tomb there. And John tells us in his gospel that he's running alongside with Simon Peter. And he looks over and he says, Simon, you're not in as good a shape as I am. And I'm faster than you. And I'm not waiting any longer. I want to get to where this empty tomb is. And John says he outruns Peter by quite a bit. And he gets to the tomb first. There he is, and he's waiting and waiting and waiting. He doesn't go in, but he waits and waits and waits. And finally, Peter comes and makes his way there. And then the Bible says Peter goes right in. And when Peter goes right in, then John follows him. Now here we are, and they are on this boat, and they have seen Jesus is resurrected. They've encountered him. And now as this great catch is going on, even though they can't really distinguish that it's Jesus out there on the shore and they've heard his voice, all of a sudden it hits John again. That's not just some man on the shore. That's the Lord. And he announces, and he looks over to Peter. He says, Peter, it's the Lord. And you know what Peter does? He says, well, John, you're not going to beat me this time. And what the Bible tells us that Peter was stripped down into his work clothes as he was working there on the boat. These men, they always had an outer garment that they would wear when they weren't working. And it was protocol when you approached someone of high standing, you would wear that outer garment when you would go to speak to them. And Peter looks over there at John, and he looks at the other disciples and said, it's going to take too long for you guys to row this boat to the shore, so I'm jumping in. And without hesitation, Peter, he grabs that outer garment, he puts it on, he dives headfirst into the Sea of Galilee, and he starts swimming as fast as he can to make it to the shore to see Jesus. All those other men are there on the boat, and they have all those fish, and they're trying to bring them to shore. Peter wasn't going to be last this time. He dove right in. It says in verse 8, since they were not far from land, about 100 yards away, the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish. Now look at this. The next miracle says, when they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish lying on it and bread. Jesus put the sun in place. Do you realize that? Jesus is the one that makes sure the sun keeps constantly having nuclear explosions on it that gives heat and light to this earth. And the sun is never going to stop doing what Jesus has told it to do until Jesus says to stop doing it. Okay? And the same Jesus that has put the sun in its place with its power and its heat and its light, there on the beach that day, he caused a fire to start burning there, a charcoal fire there on the beach. That same Jesus that had that got that charcoal fire burning on that beach, he had fish burning there on that charcoal fire there. And bread. We see with Jesus not only the miraculous catch of fish, but the miraculous fire that was burning. Just as God came to Moses in the burning bush. Friend, you say, well, preacher, you're kind of getting a little out there today. I'm not getting out there today. In fact, I'm challenging you today to stop putting a limit on what you think God can do. Stop always trying to reason everything you read in the Bible. To me, the more simple answer to these things is that Jesus, who can create like this and can do what he wants to, can create a fire on a beach with just the word of his mouth. You can have fish and bread there, preparing it for a breakfast. And when they get on the shore, verse 10 says that he said, bring some of the fish you've just caught, Jesus told them. It says, so Simon Peter climbed up and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. Now, look at this in verse 6. It said in verse 6 that they were unable to haul it in because of the large number of fish. Now, just a few moments ago, the seven disciples were unable to haul the net upon the ship. Now, when Jesus says, go get it and bring it up here on shore, Peter goes and he gets it all by himself.
Now, for me, and I don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out, it would be impossible for Peter to do the thing that the seven of them couldn't do in the beginning. What made it possible? I'll tell you what made it possible. The supernatural power of God. Listen, I know this seems like small things, doesn't it? But I believe what Jesus is doing here in this story with his disciples, Jesus is teaching them. Remember, he said, children still in need of instruction, let me instruct you about who I am and the power I have. Let me instruct you of the empowerment I can give you, the enabling I can give you. Let me instruct you of the supernatural strength that Jesus has. And so here Peter is, and all on his own, he drags the fish out. It says there's 153 of them. That's a lot of fish. Several years ago, while I was on vacation at Myrtle Beach, I was fishing at night with my brother, and we were out on the shore fishing. And that year, there were these large school of fish. I don't know what they were. They're about this big, big old fish. And I mean schools of them up close, and it would get dark. And this one evening, as we were out there fishing, there's a bunch of men from the Middle East, and they had a big net. And they were trying to catch fish at night using that net. They weren't catching a thing. And so finally, we're probably in, you know, knee deep of water, and all these fish are swimming around us and bumping us on the legs, and we're jumping because we're afraid of sharks and all that kind of stuff. Finally, we tell these guys, we say, come over here and cast out here, and you're going to catch some things. These were grown men. They throw this net out. And all of a sudden, man, they can barely pull this net in. I mean, it is full of these big fish. I don't know, 25, 30 of them. Man, it was heavy. They came from way down the beach somewhere. I mean, you should have seen them. They were running around trying to figure out what to do. One guy took off in a sprint down the beach. And all of a sudden, about 10 minutes later, here comes several more of them. And they've got coolers and buckets. And they're filling all these things up. See, this large catch of fish is important because God wants us to see that He can provide what we need. He wants us to see that He can give us a great catch. He can provide in abundance. I believe that's the reason why it says there were 153 fish. It's because when they brought it to shore, they counted them, and there were 153 fish in that net. Friends, that's a lot of fish. And it says there at the end of verse 11 that there were 153 of them, and Peter climbed and he had hauled that net ashore. And it says, even though there were so many, the net was not torn. I mean, why would God give us a detail like that here in this account? Why would He give us such a strange detail that the net wasn't torn? I'm going to tell you why. It's because God is working in supernatural power here in this account, and He wants us to see it. It would have been normal for a net full of that many fish to rip up. The net couldn't carry such a load. It couldn't carry such a haul. But God said the net is not going to rip, and it did not rip. Jesus is teaching us, and we are His children. We are His students, and He wants us to know today He has all power. If He doesn't want the net to rip, the net's not going to rip. If He wants them to catch 153 fish, they're going to catch 153 fish. If he wants Peter to go get the net and bring it on shore, even though it's too heavy for one man to do, Peter's going to go get it and bring it on shore because Jesus is going to enable him to. If Jesus wants them to catch fish on the right side of the boat instead of the left side of the boat, and all they have to do is cast it on the right side when Jesus said so, then that's what's going to happen, and they're going to catch those fish. And friend, I want you to know today, the same is true for you and me. The Jesus we read about in the Gospel of John here in chapter 21 is the same Jesus that we worship and serve. This is the same Jesus that we've been singing praises to today. This is the same Jesus who is sitting on the throne in all power and authority. This is the same Jesus who is coming back again one day. This is the same Jesus that has called and commissioned you to service in His army, in His kingdom. This is the same one. This is the same Jesus that empowers you. This is the same Jesus that equips you. This is the same Jesus that enables you. This is the same Jesus that gives you peace and comfort and joy. This is the same Jesus. And He wants us to understand this about Him. Jesus' plan for His disciples here is not for them to be fishers of fish. Jesus has already told them when He called them, they are to be fishers of men. In the same way that Jesus could have them catch many fish, Jesus is going to use them to catch many men. In fact, friend, did you know we're only here today because Jesus used those disciples to reach this world? And friend, you and I are in the same boat as these disciples. He has called us in this room. He's called His church to not be fishers of fish, but to be fishers of men. You say, what does that mean? It means He has called us to tell our friends, our families, our co-workers, people all over this world, strangers, whoever it is, He has called us to tell them that He loves them and that He will save them if they will trust in Him. That's what He's called us to. You notice as we've read this, they can do nothing without Christ. These professional fishermen couldn't catch fish on their own anymore. When they submitted to the Lordship of Christ, they submitted understanding. It's all about Him. And I can do nothing on my own. And friend, let me encourage you today. This will release you into freedom. Stop thinking you are to do things on your own. That's wrong. Mothers, Jesus hasn't called you to mother on your own and in your own strength. Fathers, Jesus hasn't called you to father on your own and in your own strength. He's not called the church to just do what the church can do in the church's own strength. In fact, the Word of God says, Jesus says, you can do nothing without Me. If we would get that through our minds, it would free us up. It would release us into knowing that when we can realize we can do nothing and He can do everything, we can submit to His Lordship. We can walk with Him and we can talk with Him. We can surrender to Him. We can be obedient to Him. Even when it doesn't make sense, we can be obedient to Him because it's not about what we know and what we can do. It's about what He knows and what He does. We can do nothing without Him. Now I want to show you something else that Jesus did. Jesus provided breakfast. Well, I tell you, it's something small, but it's something impactful. Look at it with me, if you will. It says in verse 12 that Jesus, He looked up to them and said, come and have breakfast. Come and have breakfast. Some scholars believe that the disciples had just come out of the Sabbath where they had not eaten. And at sundown, the end of the Sabbath, they then set out on that Saturday night to go fishing all night. They had not eaten the whole day prior. And now they have fished all night and they have nothing to show for it and they're kind of hungry. Which I kind of lean in that understanding, because the Bible does keep showing us and telling us that Jesus keeps coming and appearing to his disciples on Sunday morning. So that would mean that this was on a Sunday morning that Jesus is out there on the beach. And out there on the beach that Sunday morning, Jesus has that fire and he has got a great breakfast ready for them. They come onto the shore and they are ready to eat. And Jesus says, come and have breakfast with me. Now, Jesus will provide. Isn't that wonderful to know? Not only did Jesus provide a catch for them out there on the sea, but he provided breakfast. But I believe in Jesus providing breakfast, he's actually providing them one other piece of instruction that he wants them to know about himself. And I want you to hear this. Jesus, he has compassion for you. He has compassion for you. One of the most intimate things that we do as people is we share meals together. That's a very special thing we do. We share meals. Especially in the first century there in Palestine, it was a very special thing to share a meal with somebody, a friend, a neighbor. When you have somebody over to your home and you prepare a meal for them, it's special to that person. It shows them how much you care for them, how much thought you put into things. Jesus has come on the beach and he has prepared a meal, and then he gives an invitation to his disciples. He says, come and eat with me. Come and have breakfast. Now, of all the meals that we share with one another, I was thinking, it may be different for you, but for me, I started thinking about, I have not shared a lot of breakfast meals with people. I really haven't. Compared to other meals, lunch and dinner, it's almost like breakfast is even more intimate. You know, you don't just get up and go have breakfast with anybody, typically. I mean, Chelsea's up working in the nursery. I mean, even as husband and wife, we rarely are able to go somewhere and have breakfast together. And when we do, it's maybe if we're able to go on a trip by ourselves or something, and we'll try to have breakfast together one time. And when we have breakfast together, there's just something real special and intimate about that setting. Jesus has invited his disciples. He has invited you. He has sent an invitation out to you. And he says, come and eat with me. Come, have breakfast with me. I have prepared all that you need. The table is set. The fire is warm. The fish are broiled. The bread is toasted. Come, I have prepared it. Come, dine with me. Jesus says, I want to be with you. Don't you want to be with me? Come, enjoy this compassion that I have for you. Come and find rest. You know, life is hard. Life was hard for the disciples. Life is hard for you. Life is trying. It is difficult. But Jesus has compassion towards you. And he wants to give you rest. He desires for you to accept his invitation to meet with him. Can you believe that today, friend? Jesus, who created this universe, he has said, I've got time for you. He said, I've got time for you. Come. Rest with me. Dine with me. Have breakfast. If you'll receive Jesus' invitation this morning, tomorrow morning, the next morning, the day after that. Friend, you will find rest and peace. I believe today that it may very well be the hardest and most taxing but yet rewarding calling in life is the calling of motherhood. Now that I have kids of my own and a wife, I'm able to see it from a new perspective. I see how difficult, how trying, how taxing, how mothers just roll up their sleeves every single day, every single hour, every single minute. They're rarely appreciated. The world, friends, and let me just tell you this right now. Mothers and women have a full-on assault upon them from the evil one today. The world attacks women and mothers. Now, I want all the kids to look up. I know I put you to sleep. I want all the kids to look up at me right now. You looking? You need to hear this from the pulpit. The only people that can be mothers is a woman. Did you hear me? Now, you need to understand that. Some of you don't even understand why I'm saying that today. But you need to hear it. You need to understand that the only people that God has called to be mothers are women. And we are going to live in a world, in a society from here on forward, where mothers and women, you're constantly going to be under attack. And you're going to be put down for the calling of being a mother. You're going to be ridiculed for saying, the greatest calling in my life is not my job, it's not my profession. The greatest calling in my life is being a mother. Amen. And you'll be put down for that. You'll be ridiculed for that. You won't be given a promotion. You'll be given a demotion. But I want you to know today that God sees what you're doing as a mother. And God knows the high calling that He has given to you as a mother. God knows that you're the only one that can be a mother to your children. God knows that He didn't choose just anybody to be mothers, but He chose women to be mothers. And friends, I want you to know one day that you might not sense a reward or some type of appreciation from the world, but friends, get ready, because you're going to be surprised at how God rewards you in heaven for being faithful to the calling that He has called you to. Don't worry today about what the world would say about you as a mother. You just keep your eyes focused on the calling that Jesus has given you. And friend, one day you're going to stand before Him and you're going to be given an account for what you have done in this earth. And God's going to say, I called you to be a mother. And He's going to say, and you did it. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Come into the joy of your master. Friends, I am convinced that motherhood is one of the most tying, trying, and taxing and difficult callings in this world given to women. But friend, He's not called you to do it on your own. Just as He enabled Peter to go and get that net. Just as He provided that breakfast, just as He provided that fish, just as He has provided that instruction, Jesus will enable you to stay faithful and do the best job you can do, empowered by the Holy Spirit. You keep your eyes focused on Him. And remember what he says. He says, are you tired? Are you weary? Do you need help? Do you need some comfort? He has given you the invitation, just as he gave his disciples. He says, come and be with me. Come. Come dine with me. Come have breakfast, and you will see the compassionate hand of Jesus who will hold you up. Father, I thank you for your goodness. And Lord, I thank you for your grace and your mercy. Lord, forgive us for our sin. Father, thank you for giving us your only begotten Son. Jesus, thank you for inviting us to be with you every single day, every single moment. Jesus, thank you for the rest that we find in you, the comfort we find in you. Thank you for the refreshment we find in you as we come and we dine with you at your glorious table. Jesus, thank you for empowering us for the service you've called us to. Thank you for empowering us in the callings. Thank you for empowering the mothers in this room, the grandmothers in this room. God, thank you for empowering the fathers in this room and the grandfathers in this room. God, thank you for the young men and women here that one day are going to be mothers and one day are going to be fathers. God, thank you that you will empower them and equip them for what you have called them to in this life. Jesus, thank you for reminding us today that you have all power and authority. Being resurrected, you still perform miracles. God, maybe someone here today just needs a miracle in their life. May they ask you for it, and may your will be done. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you would please stand. We have a moment of response here. I'll be standing down front. David's going to lead us. You can sing along as he leads. This is an invitation. If God is dealing in your heart in some area, I want you to come and share that with me. Perhaps you need to trust in Jesus for salvation and find that final rest in Him. Come. He's got the table prepared for you. Maybe God is leading you to follow Him in baptism because you've never been baptized after being saved and you know that's what God wants you to do. Come and tell me. God's leading you to become a part of the fellowship of our church through membership. Come and let me know. Maybe you just need to come here and pray. Maybe you need to bring a burden to God here at the altar and lift it to Him. Come and pray. This time is for you to make decisions for Christ. Please come as we sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Today would be a great day for you to make a decision for Christ. Please come.
Happy the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back.
Father, Lord, we thank you for your goodness to us today, for meeting with us and teaching us according to your word. And God, I just want to thank you for our mothers today. I want to thank you for all they mean to us, those that are still with us and those that are with you. And God, help us to leave this place today knowing Jesus. That you have taught us, just as you did your disciples that day by the Sea of Galilee, that you still have all power and you have compassion, and that we can come and dine with you every day. We love you and we praise you. Holy Spirit, be with us as we leave this place and go out into this world. Help us to make much of Jesus, and it's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen. Before you're dismissed, I want to thank you for being here today. I want to remind you, if you want to get a picture up here at this photo drop, you can do that. Also, get you some flowers on the way out, mothers. And God bless you. We are dismissed.